Hello, good evening everybody. I welcome you all to this Know More About BiSEP webinar series. Today's webinar is second in the series. The first one we had on 3rd August 2018. I am Dr. Balasubramanya. I am senior consultant in Karnataka, Innovation and Technology Society, Department of IT, BT, Government of Karnataka. In our efforts to bring awareness among students about BiSEP, we conducted webinar on 3rd August. Wherein we had shared with you the details of why and how Government of Karnataka started this unique BTFS program in 2011, and about 700 plus students being trained with a good percentage of job placement, a good percentage of job record, and how in the second phase we renamed the program as Biotechnology Skill Enhancement Program, and based on the feedback from the industry and various associations. We have improved the curriculum to provide the job role based training so that the students joining the program are assured of placement at the end of the training program. We also introduced in the last webinar three subdomains of biotechnology, namely cellular and molecular diagnostics, clinical research and data management, and nutraceutical and food processing, and how if you select these domains as subject of your training, the opportunities that are available in those domains has been explained by the course coordinators. The same now is available in our YouTube channel. Those who have did not join our last program or last webinar, so you are requested to view the same. It's available on the YouTube channel, and it probably after this webinar you can have a view at it, so that you have a clear understanding about all the domains, and based on that probably you can select your domains and the study of training, training what you want to undergo also. After the first webinar, we got lot many requests from students asking us to do another series explaining about the remaining domains also. So for that purpose, we have come out in front of you now, and all the coordinators of other domains, they'll be speaking to you or giving lot many information. And based on that, again, you can decide upon which what is the area of study you want to pursue as your career. And because when we had almost another six domains to be, which you have to, tell you about. So it will be 2 hours program. I request all the students, people who are watching, to be patient and listen fully, and try to understand the job kind of the training kind of what you are giving, the training what you are trying to give, and what kind of placement opportunity that are available in the domains. And at the end of the program, if time permits and based on some students' request, so some more details about nutraceuticals and food processing, as well as cellular and molecular diagnostics, will be provided by the coordinators. I request all to hear all the details. That's all. Then second thing is that apart from that, we have some questions were asked about registration, online examination, hostel, all those things. So all these are already available in the website. I request the students to please visit the website. And if still you have any more doubts, you can always send us a message by means of email or WhatsApp messages. So we are available to provide the information. Now I request the first speaker, Dr. S. Kiran from the Dayanand Sagar College of Engineering. So he'll be speaking about plant genetic engineering domain. Thank you.
Yeah. Good afternoon. Myself, I'm Dr. Kiran. I'm the course coordinator at Dayanand Sagar College of Engineering for the BiSEP program. And the domain that Dayanand Sagar College of Engineering has got is plant genetic engineering. As you know, today introducing genes into plants to create new commercially used varieties is a trivial task. And today, with the development of new technologies, it has made much been easier. And this technology is being used to address problems in the areas of agriculture production and processing, molecular farming, environmental remediation, and biofuel production. Globally, 81% of soybean and cotton that are grown, they are GM crops. 35% of corn and 30% of canola grown globally, they are GM. And 90% of the corn grown in North America is GM crops. Coming to the Indian scenario, in India, 5 million small farmers, they are benefited from 7.6 million hectare of BT cotton, which is equivalent to 82% of the 9.3 million hectare national cotton crops. And India has also developed the GM technology for crops such as brinjal and mustard. And these are expected to be released in the near future with the government approval. So with the controversies of direct gene manipulation by cloning and transformation, so currently scientists, they are relying on gene editing technologies. So several approaches to gene editing technologies have been developed. And a recent one is known as the CRISPR-Cas9, which in short for clustered regularly interspaced short palindromic repeats and CRISPR-associated protein 9. So this, the CRISPR-Cas9 system has generated a lot of excitement in the scientific community because of its faster, cheaper, more accurate, and more efficient than other existing genome editing methods. Many industries are involved in the use of molecular markers in breeding, genome editing, cloning, and characterization of economically important genes against pests, pathogens, salinity stress, etc., and also in commercial micropropagation of some of these crops. So globally, if you look at the area that is covered under the GM crops, you can see that way back in 1998, so it was about 1.7 million hectare, and in 2017, it is close to 189.8 million hectare. And the top GM growing countries as of 2017 is USA stands first at 75 million hectare, followed by Brazil, Argentina, Canada, and India. India stands at the fifth position with 9.4 million hectare of GM crops, that is particularly GM cotton. So the percentage of GM crops in the US that has changed the entire GM scenario in US. So from 1997 to 2008, for some of the crops can be seen here. And the source for this is IS AAA. So wherein the students can log into this and to know more about the GM crops and its technologies is available. So now, what is the role of plant genetic engineers in producing sustainable agriculture? So increasing global crop productivity to improve food, feed, and fiber, contributing to the food security by sustainable crop production system. We can be put into four different groups, that is molecular biology, plant biochemistry, molecular markers, as well as plant tissue culture. So in molecular biology, you will be studying about the isolation of this. All these are practical based skills. You will be learning about the isolation of genomic DNA, RNA for molecular analysis, then isolation of plasmid DNAs, preparation of chemical and electrocompetent cells, transformations, gene cloning methods, both the directional cloning and vector constructions, and transgene analysis by PCR as well as RT-PCR, then Western Southern and dot blot techniques. And the different molecular markers that you would be studying in this program is RAPD, ISSR markers, RFLP, SSR, and finally GMO detection. And along this, you'll also be looking and studying the plant biochemistry part of it, wherein you will purify the proteins and also do an analysis of HPLC and ELISA. And to do all these components, you require a small amount of plant tissue culture, wherein we'll have a transformation, plant transformation carried by agrobacterium mediated transformations and callosine suspension cultures and some of the microbiation techniques that will be imparted to you in this particular skill. So briefly coming to the highlights of this program at Dhanasar College of Engineering. So this program is a postgraduate diploma program and it is affiliated to Dhanasagar University. And also the students will also be assessed by LSSDC, that is Life Science Sector Development Council Corporation, for two job roles, that is QC biologist and product development biologist, which has got great demand in crop biotechnology industries. And in the institution, we also have catering to the needs of the soft skills. We have a separate dedicated center called as a Center for Innovation Leadership, and also a semi-commercial plant tissue culture laboratory, which provides professional environment and also motivates the students to become entrepreneurs. So these are some of our industry partners for which we are tied up, for wherein the students will be pursuing their internship: Monsanto, then DuPont, Myco Seeds, Metahelix Life Sciences, Lima Grain, Solar Agrotech Private Limited, Ajit Seeds Aurangabad, Pioneer Hybrid Seeds, Reliance Life Sciences Mumbai, Oris Life Sciences, Cryogene, Biogenomics, then Crabfish Technologies, then Amrut Seeds in Bangalore. So before I complete, I would like to tell you that students with BSc Agriculture background, that is 4 years BSc Agriculture, they are also eligible to take up this program on plant genetic engineering. And apart from Dhanasar College of Engineering, this program is also being offered at Institute of Agribiotech, IABT, Dharwad, wherein you can contact Dr. Nadaf, the coordinator there, and get in touch with him for any queries. Thank you.
Yeah, very good afternoon, everybody. Myself, Dr. B.S. Gaurishankar, I'm BiSEP coordinator, so Department of Biotechnology, Siddhaganga Institute of Technology, Tumkuru. So our domain is bioinformatics and big data analytics. So any biotechnology will not be completed without in silico work. So for that, so bioinformatics and big data analytics is the only domain which is provided in this all among 18 institutes in this program. So first of all, let us know that what is that bioinformatics and big data analytics. So bioinformatics is the computer assisted data management discipline that help us gather, analyze and represent this information in order to educate ourselves, understand life process in healthy and disease states, and find new or better drugs. So again, in addition to the bioinformatics, is being practiced worldwide by academic groups, companies, and national and international research consortia. So bioinformatics has established itself in the last decade as a foundation of modern biotechnology. Recent advancements in sequencing have made enormous contributions to understanding the biology of life forms. So coming to the big data analytics, so big data is pouring out of life sciences research, creating ample opportunities for scientists with computer science expertise. In this regard, the bioinformatics and big data analytics program has been designed to train students to understand, analyze, interpret, and manage the biological big data using bioinformatics tools and software. The fact that bioinformatics has emerged as a key tool for drug discovery process due to its high throughput screening, aided by recent advancements in proteomics and genomics, is largely responsible for driving the global market. In addition, the various initiatives undertaken by government coupled with the developments in the IT sector are helping propel the market growth. On the other hand, shortage of skilled bioinformatics professionals and lack of adequate user-friendly tools are the major factors restraining the growth of this. Big data analytics in healthcare. So global big data analytics in healthcare market was valued at ₹10,725 crores in 2016 and is estimated to reach at ₹36,093 crores by 2023, growing at a cumulative annual growth rate of 19.1% from 2017 to 2023. So we'd like to know that what are the some big projects so which is doing at presently: the human genome and proteome projects, the cancer genome atlas, genome-wide association studies, international HapMap project, encyclopedia of DNA elements project. So coming to the areas of bioinformatics and big data analytics in global version, so we can classify that one as four categories. One is global bioinformatics market. Another one is global bioinformatics market by technology and services. And third one, it is global bioinformatics market by sector. And the last one, it is global bioinformatics market dynamics. So look at that, the growth of this big data analytics here. Under this global bioinformatics market, it is estimated that there is a significant growth of 21.2% from 2014 to 2020. So there is enormous opportunity in even global bioinformatics market by technology and services. So some of the areas which are including in this is genomics, chemoinformatics and drug design, proteomics, transcriptomics and metabolomics. So other area which is the one that is the global bioinformatics market by sector. So there are other items which are medical bioinformatics, animal bioinformatics, agricultural bioinformatics, academics, and other which is included in this. The last one, the global bioinformatics market by dynamics. So there are some drivers that is need for integrated data, increasing growth in proteomics and genomics, drug discovery and development, and the last one, government initiatives. So in North America, the highest revenue generating segment, it is a global informatics market by sector. It is around 5.1 billion by 2020. So let me share with you that what are the major companies so which are involved in this bioinformatics and big data analytics. So some of the major companies in global bioinformatics market are: one is Life Technologies USA, Illumina Inc USA, Agilent Technologies USA, GE Healthcare USA, Strand Life Science Bangalore India, Genotypic Technology Bangalore India, Quantum Zion LPP Bangalore India, Xcode Life Sciences Chennai India, Serogem Bangalore India, Medgenome Bangalore India. So our institute is having very that is a memorandum of understanding with some of the bioinformatics company like Bioinnovate Technology Private Limited Bangalore, Lab P53 Cancer Research Vellore, Xcode Life Sciences Chennai, Quantum Zyme Bangalore, Kaivur Genomics Chennai, Bangalore Genomics Center Bangalore, Polyclode Bioservices Bangalore. So some of other industries also tie up with our institute. So you should know that who are the scientists involved in making the growth of this bioinformatics and big data analytics. I am happy to share that all are from, I mean, from IISc and very reputed institutes. Dr. B. Jayaram, so he is a professor, Department of Chemistry and School of Biological Sciences, IIT Delhi. So his focus area is bioinformatics and computational biology. And next is Dr. Sanjeev Srivastav. So he's associate professor, Department of Bioscience and Bioengineering, IIT Bombay. His area of research is biorepositories for cancer research. And Dr. Akhilesh Pandey, director, Institute of Bioinformatics. So his focus area is omics, including genomics and proteomics. Dr. Andrew Michael Lin is professor, School of Computational and Integrative Sciences, JNU, New Delhi. Dr. Gromia, associate professor, Protein Bioinformatics Laboratory, IIT Madras. So his focus area is protein bioinformatics. Dr. Raja is the founder and CEO, Genotypic Technology. So his area of interest is the microRNA services and next generation sequencing. Dr. Vijay Chandru, co-founder and chairman of Strand Life Sciences. So his research is based on in silico technology. Dr. Tapas Kumar Kundu is a professor and head of biotechnology, JNCSR. So his focused area is transcription and disease. And Professor N. Ethindra is a former director, Institute of Bioinformatics and Applied Biotechnology. So his area was sequencing and analysis of diseases. So presently, Dr. H.S. Subramania is the director of IBAB and Biocon Chair. So what are the latest trends which is making this bioinformatics and big data analytics, which is very much interested and having high scope in the future? So first reason is, as biomedical research becomes increasingly data intensive, the use of computation methods have become increasingly common. And technology wise, it is the advanced techniques, that is next generation sequencing technology, will be used. And we have some sensitive instrument with related to the advance in instrumentation. And since it is only in silico work, there is a reduced cost for sequencing projects. And advances in information technology, so that better hardware and software facilities are available. The expanding BE, expanding that big data universe, and landing big data job is also having high future. And there is a demand for resources who can analyze the data using computer bioinformatician. So you should know that what are the national and international status of India bioinformatics industry. So this is, as you know that the bioinformatics is one of the fastest expanding fields in India biotechnology sector today. So there are 300 companies in Bangalore, Hyderabad, Pune, Chennai and Delhi that are in some way involved in bioinformatics. And bioinformatics network is very huge. India is one of the first countries in the world to establish a nationwide bioinformatics network. The Department of Biotechnology, DBT, initiated a program on bioinformatics in 1986. The Biotechnology Information System Network, a division of DBT, now connects 168 key research centers covering the entire country. India's well-known software skills are, of course, another key advantage in global bioinformatics. There is a freedom to operate in India and perform data analysis related to genome sequencing, functional genomics, proteomics field. So how is the carriers and demand of, for this bioinformatics and big data analytics? So it is, so we have the DNA and genome information, protein sequencing and pathways, so which are more interested. And secondly, there are many carriers options available to a trained bioinformatics specialist, ranging from medical research to database management or software development. And the third one, the overall job outlook for bioinformatics scientist career has been positive since 2004. Vacancies for this career have increased by 16.23% nationwide in that time, with an average growth of 2.7% per year. So demand for bioinformatics scientist is expected to go up, with an expected 7,170 new jobs filled by 2020. This represents an annual increase of 2.95% over the next few years. So course summary that our institute, so we have this curriculum for that PG diploma course of this domain. Subjects are bioinformatics, then genome informatics and big data analytics, computer programming, and business development. So these are the subjects which will be collected by the input given by the our MOU industries and the laboratories in according to the theory subject what we taught in the class. So that is bioinformatics, genome informatics, and big data analytics. So after a 6 months program in the class, I mean in institute, then the another 6 months is for the internship. So apart from this, we have many softwares in the institute. So drug discovery software and the genome workbench and awardees NGS, etc. So that will be used by our students. So just to know the learning of this big data analytics and the application of bioinformatics. So thank you for listening. If you have any queries, you can ask the questions later.
Good afternoon to all. So my name is Dr. Keshav Prasad. I am a course coordinator for Multi-Omics Technology domain under the BiSEP program. So I belong to Anapoya deemed to be university, which was a medical college earlier, and recently started expanding the facilities which are required for high-end science. It is an AK accredited institute with the four constituent colleges, mainly catering the needs of health sciences. And it offers 11 undergraduate and 45 postgraduate courses. And we have established Anapoya Research Center around 8 years ago. And we mainly focus on areas which have basic implications in health sciences. So investment in R&D has been done for the with a budget of around 200 lakhs. So for the next 2 to 3 years. So Anapoya Research Center has established a very well structured laboratories, including molecular biology, cell culture, nanotechnology, biostatistics and bioinformatics, analytical division, and applied microbiology and biotechnology division. And in recently, with the stem cell and regenerative medicine center, as well as a center for systems biology and molecular medicine. So with all these facilities across that, we have been shortlisted and selected for this giving skill development in the area of multi-omics technology, which includes genomics, proteomics, and metabolomics, ably assisted with a group of experts in bioinformatics. So we have state-of-art facilities established recently, which involves high-resolution mass spectrometers, mainly with the Orbitrap fusion mass spectrometer and a Qtrap 6500 mass spectrometer, which is mainly used for biomedical discoveries of novel molecules and mechanisms which are involved in diseases as well as in the agricultural sector and in the livestock management. So once we discover these molecules, it will be giving us a platform for taking off the further improvements and translation towards cell and molecular diagnostics and also agricultural sector. So the scope of this particular field, as explained by Dr. Kavishri in the initial BiSEP series seminar 1, so where she has detailed the market of cellular and molecular diagnostics, and which actually forms the cornerstone of our skill area of skill development also. because as narrated by her, if anybody has presented in the last webinar, you can recall that as given by Indian Diagnostics Services Market Outlook, and there is a huge increase in the market of cellular and molecular diagnostics and also the biomolecular research. So which is evidenced by around 27% growth as well, and around 400% growth in the research area. So with this, where it will be applied is, the scope of application is, I can just, if I can give some examples, for example, these discoveries help in the translation potential of novel molecules in the area of detection of infectious diseases, detection of tumor DNA in the blood, which will help in detect the recurrence very earlier than the current methodologies which are there in the field, which we call now as liquid biopsy. And then if used effectively with the better cohort management and discovery programs, we can detect, we can possibly come up with lot of solutions for the future for early detection of various cancers and especially the deep-seated tumors, which will result in better treatment outcome. So multi-omics domain as such is given by only our group in all the system, although it has a very good complementarity with the other groups like cell and molecular diagnostics. This domain is offered by four constituent colleges in the BiSEP program, called Oxford College of Science, School of Life Sciences Manipal, and Mount Carmel College and SDM Dharwad. And once the proteins are identified, they have to be expressed and scaled up. So that particular domain is given by JSS College Mysore. And as previously just you heard, Dr. Gauri Shankar has explained in detail how bioinformatics and data analysis also growing up area where they actually use the data which is generated by multi-omics domain. So with this, I also wanted to emphasize the area that the people who teach multi-omics domain in our group are highly talented and they are very young, and each one of them have done this kind of analysis more than 100 times by now in the last 4 to 5 years of their career. So I would like to introduce Dr. Sneha Pinto, Dr. Ashwan Subbanaya, and then Dr. Pratigya Subba, as seen in this slide, and Dr. Prashant and Dr. Mr. Arun Patil. All of them have done different aspects of multi-omics, including genomics, proteomics, and metabolomics, and the data analysis associated with that. And then our students, as well as faculties, have conducted more than 50 national workshops on this emerging area of omics technologies, which has actually given a lot of confidence to our people who are involved in daily teaching on this domain. So now I will come to give you an overview of where the applications will be. That is, multi-omics approach is a technology, it's the amalgamation of technology which involves genomics, where we work on DNA profiling, and then transcriptomics, where we work on RNA profiling, and microRNA, and some total of metabolites, and proteins and their modifications. And once you have data from all the sets of different layers of this particular area, we finally can put together in a systems level approach. There are several international projects have been working in this area, like TCGA or NCI 60 to name a few, and has given a lot of contribution towards novel molecular discoveries and data analytics. So these are each level of this layer of different layers of omics give a different types of data sets, and they have to be done using different approaches and methodologies. So now, when it comes to the cascade to explain how they are related with each other, you can see from the, you can appreciate from this particular slide, the genomics can tell you that what can happen. So once you have genome data, the next comes in the particular domain, that is transcriptomics, which will tell what is appeared to be happening. Then proteins are the real blueprints of the real molecules which make things happen on a particular biological context. And metabolites actually are regulated by proteins and protein groups, and finally affect the phenotype. With these data sets, they are highly interrelated. So among these, we have done sufficiently high number of projects on proteomics and genomics, but metabolomics is a recent addition to our area, where we have started working on metabolomics of various Ayurvedic drugs and traditional medicines, and combined that with the metabolomics of diseases, how the metabolites change during the disease outcome. And we also develop a lot of databases which are required for metabolomics to harness its real strength, and also algorithms using new softwares using bioinformatics approaches. So the main job-oriented training in multi-omics are required. A lot of skill gap is there in the area of sample prep, instrumentation, as well as data analysis. All of the omics go with these three areas. So in genomics, we can do multiple applications, like you have whole genome sequencing, then metagenomics, exome analysis of medical cases, transcriptomics. Among the proteomics, we will also learn about quantitative proteomics, how to do targeted proteomics, and multiple PTMs. So among metabolomics, we have already established global protocol for global analysis, as well as targeted analysis, and also database management. Finally, bioinformatics combines all this data to give us meaningful molecules by using gene set enrichment and molecular networks and pathways. So I wanted to just see that students who joined our group can actually mingle with our PhD student to multiple iterations to learn each and every skill gaps. So although they have been given training one or two times, then they can mingle with our faculties and students when they are under routine this one to have more iteration of their training. So as I told you earlier, mainly we will train you in the area of NGS analysis, characterization of biosimilars and therapeutics, analysis of nucleotides and small molecules, quality testing of drugs and drug products. So then discovery of novel proteins and signaling pathways involved in diseases, livestock and crop plants, molecular targets of traditional medicine, and development of novel quality standards. And these are all very highly sought after areas in the industry, and then integrated omics analysis. So coming to the last slide of mine, so where are the opportunities with the industry partners? So each area of integration, like proteomics and targeted proteomics, mainly all the proteomics industry, including Thermo Fisher, SCIEX, Patanjali, Strands Biosciences, Agilent Technologies, these are the area companies one can look for. And then in genomics and next-gen sequencing analysis, there are a number of institutions or companies one can get the job role enrolled. And then functional proteomics and data analytics, there are several database-oriented companies and data annotation companies where people can get enrolled. And then metabolomics and functional proteomics makes a key role in quality control and the novel drug development and metabolomic based or Ayurvedic based drug market which comes in future. So with this, I will leave the stage for the next speaker, Dr. Bindu, who will speak in the area of biopharmaceuticals, where you will get more applications of this particular area. Thank you. Thank you, Anil.
Hello everyone, I am Dr. Bindu S, Program Coordinator of the BiSEP program and Professor and Head at the Department of Biotechnology, MS Ramaiah Institute of Technology, or Ramaiah Institute of Technology as it is called recently. We are situated in Bangalore. The Department of Biotechnology offers a postgraduate diploma program in biopharmaceutical technology under the Biotechnology Skill Enhancement Program. The program curriculum is designed to prepare students for employment in the biopharma and allied sectors involved in pharmaceutical research, development, and manufacturing. The program was conceived in response to the availability of exciting job opportunities within India's large and expanding biopharmaceutical sector. Biopharmaceuticals constitute the largest segment of the biotech industry, both in terms of domestic and export revenues. The biopharmaceutical industry in India is growing at a rate of about 30% to 40% per annum, with a turnover of over 12 crore rupees presently. In the biopharma sector, we have various areas. So this sector consists of development of vaccines, biosimilars, therapeutics, diagnostics, regenerative medicines, and various medical technologies. Vaccines and biosimilars constitute the largest component of the Indian biopharma segment. So here you can also see a position mapping of the biopharmaceutical technology in the biotechnology sector. As you can see that we have like a dovetailing of agri and food biotech, then environmental and medical and health biotechnology when we talk of biotechnology, and the biopharmaceutical technology domain kind of comes in this area of medical and health biotechnology. And in the program that we are offering, we would be training students in upstream, downstream process technology, as well as in fermentation technology. Now, the program that we are offering, it builds on the faculty expertise, infrastructural facilities, and industry links that our institute, MSRIT, has in this domain. The students also will have the additional opportunity to learn due to their interaction with students of other ongoing academic programs of the department and the institute. Like we have BA biotechnology programs, we have MTech biotechnology program, and PhD programs. The curriculum of the program has been tailored keeping in mind the latest advancements in the field as per industry requirements. The first 6 months of the program includes coursework and laboratory training, which will be delivered by MSRIT faculty and collaborating industry experts. The industrial internship during the next 6 months of this 1 year postgraduate diploma program that we offer will provide hands-on training to the students and will aid in improving their technical skill sets. Effectiveness of this learning program will be assessed by regular grading, which is done by MSRIT faculty and industry experts. The students will be placed for internship in leading biotech companies that the department has collaborations with. Some of the partner industries are Biocon, Hindustan Unilever or Unilever Research, Himalaya Drug Company, Sami Labs, Gangajan, Genotypic, Aristogene, Connexious Life Sciences, Equity Labs, and Celeste. And these are only some of the formal understandings that we have with some of the industries. We also have several other collaborations for various other programs that are ongoing in the department. We also have a collaboration with Novozymes, Beckman Coulter, and several other companies. These internships can eventually lead to placements for the students. So we organize a whole lot of industry collaborated programs. As you can see here, this is one of the workshops that was organized at our institute. So from the 6th to the 9th of June. So this workshop on cytoflex flow cytometry applications in biotechnology was organized in collaboration with Beckman Coulter Life Sciences Bengaluru under IEEE EMBS professional chapter. We've also conducted several other workshops, one of it being the hands-on training program that we have provided for our BiSEP students on laboratory biosafety, which is one of the important aspects that students should be aware of while they are enrolled in this program and later on when they work in an industry. The department also organizes several invited talks by industry experts and also from experts from R&D institutes. So as you can see here, few of the images that are shown here, some of them are representative of the invited talks. We had Dr. UV Babu, who's the head of phytochemistry at the Himalaya Drug Company, come over and give a talk to our students. Then we had Mr. Jitin Mohan, who is with Beckman Coulter, who talked about flow cytometry applications. Then we have Ms. Indrila Das Gupta from Novozymes. She's their business development manager. She's also on the advisory board of the department. And she again came and talked to the students about opportunities that are available in this biopharma sector. We had Mr. Vignesh, who's an alumni of the department. He is with Biocon, he's with QC Microbiology. So he also came over just last week and spoke to our students about opportunities in QC and Biocon and other allied biotech industries. We also regularly organize industrial visits for our students. As you can see here, we had organized a visit to Beckman Coulter during the workshop that was organized, visits to IBAB, then the Bangalore Bioinnovation Center, and our students also visited the Himalaya Drug Company and visited Biocon. So the students who enroll in the postgraduate diploma program in the domain area of biopharmaceutical technology at MSRIT will have strengthened fundamental knowledge in core areas through lecture classes, practical hands-on training through extensive laboratory sessions, enhanced practical skill sets through workshops and training program modules, regular visits to leading biotech industries, invited talks by experts from the industry and R&D institutes, seminar presentations and group discussions, soft skill enhancement programs. The department has several ongoing collaborations with industries. We have several of the industry experts on various committees of the department. We have a department advisory board in which we have prominent industry experts from several of the partner industries that I just mentioned to you. We have from Biocon, we have from the Himalaya Drug Company, from Unilever, from Sartorius, from Beckman Coulter, Novozymes, to name a few. Even on the Board of Studies of the department, we have representation from industry experts. We have from Bristol Myers Squibb, we have from Connexius. So this is mostly all about the biopharmaceutical technology program that is being offered by the Department of Biotechnology, MSRIT. So if your passion is biopharmaceutical technology, then your destination should be MSRIT. So thank you. And I will now invite the next speaker from SDM Ujre, Ms. J. Prarthana. So her domain is fermentation and bioprocess engineering.
Good evening, one and all. Myself, I'm Prarthana. I'm a BiSEP course coordinator for fermentation and bioprocessing in PG Department of Biotechnology at SDMC Ujre. To begin with, biotechnology skill enhancement program. It's a very unique initiative of Government of India in association with LSSDC, CSIR. IICT as well as ABLE. So we at SDMC Ujre, we are very proud and privileged to be recognized as one of the 18 institutions to run the industry-oriented skill development course as a part of our PG Diploma of Fermentation and Bioprocessing. So biotechnology, as we all know, is the culmination of more than 8,000 years of human experience using living organism and the process of fermentation to make products such as bread, cheese, beer, wine, etc. Today, biotechnology is applied to the manufacturing process used in the healthcare, food, as well as industry, agriculture, etc. When a biotechnological process is implemented on commercial scale, there is every reason to believe that it will be in some bioreactor or fermenter, where the entire process will be divided into three stages, which we call it as upstream processing, which involves the preparation of liquid media, separation of particulate and inhibitory chemical molecules from the media, sterilization, and air purification. The second stage is termed as fermentation, which involves the conversion of substrate into desired product with the help of biological agents, which we can use either in the form of microorganism, plant cells, or any other living organism. Third stage is the downstream processing, which involves separation of cells from the fermentation froth, purification and concentration of desired product and waste disposal or the recycling. As I already mentioned that we are offering the domain fermentation and bioprocessing. Bioprocessing is something wherein using of a complete living cell or their components such as bacteria, enzymes or chloroplasts are done to obtain the desired product. So it is here where the transport of energy and mass is fundamental to many of the biological and environmental process areas, from food processing to thermal design of building to the biomedical devices to the pollution control and global warming require knowledge of how to use energy and mass, which gets transported through the materials. So as such, bioprocessing is a specialization of biotechnology, chemical engineering, as well as agriculture engineering. It deals with the design and development of the equipments and the processes for the manufacturing of products such as food, feed, pharmaceutical, nutraceuticals, chemicals, and polymers, papers from the biological material. So bioprocess engineering, we can call it as a conglomerate of mathematics, biology, and industrial designs. So the main aim of the course is to review the fundamentals and provide an up-to-date account of current knowledge in the biological and biochemical technology. This program has been designed with an employer-driven curriculum which has more emphasis on practical experience to the students to develop adequate skills to fit into the industry standard and through specialist learning modules. Fermentation and bioprocessing is a common scientific platform which includes a wide range of disciplines under its scope. This course emphasizes on the application of biological and engineering principles to the problems involving microbial, algal, plant, mammalian, and biological or biochemical systems. Any industrial fermentation operation can be broken down into three main stages as bioprocess, which involves upstream processing, fermentation process, and downstream processing, which already I had mentioned, wherein fermentation means a process in which the microorganisms that are cultured on a large scale under aerobic or anaerobic conditions convert a substrate into a product which is useful to the human source. The upstream process is defined as an entire process from early cell isolation and its cultivation to cell banking and cell culture expansion of the cells until the final harvest is obtained. The downstream process part of bioprocess refers to the cell mass from the upstream are processed to meet the purity and quality of the requirements. So here in fermentation and bioprocessing domain, the students will be trained on different aspects such as fermentation, upstream, downstream processing, production or manufacturing, quality control, quality assurance, facility management, and applications of fermentation. In addition, the course also emphasizes on regulatory requirements of different countries, CGMP requirements for the production area of biopharmaceuticals, which will also be covered. Students will also be involved in hands-on research, making papers as well as poster presentation and attending for various national and state level conferences. The tailored skill policies based on our industry partners and monitoring of the skill gap allows us to improve the individuals to work in pharmaceuticals and biopharmaceutical, chemical, food and beverage, diagnostic companies, legal and consultant companies, and as various government institutions. So the industries which cater to the domain fermentation and bioprocessing includes Biocon, Serum Institute of India, Panacea Biotech, Reliance Life Sciences, Shanta Biotech, Novo Nordisk, Bharat Biotech, Candela Healthcare, Intex Biopharma, Hafkin Biopharma, Glasgow Smith & Klein, Strides, etc. So the present scenario of Indian biotech sector is around 2% of total biotechnology industry which are shared in the world. Indian biotech sector are expected to go from current US $5 to $7 billion to US $100 billion by the year 2025. And biotechnology industry in India has grown nearly threefold in last 5 years to reach US $4 to $5 billion. Presently, India has been ranked as 12th in the world and as second in the Asia in the biotechnology sector. Approximately 40% of the Indian biotech revenue are known to come from the Bangalore, which has been ranked among the 12 top biotech destinations globally. Pharmaceutical and health biotechnology is one of the India's fast growing sector. wherein the biopharmaceuticals account for nearly 64% of the Indian biotech industries, which are valued greater than nearly $4 billion, growing at an average of nearly 20 to 25% per annum. Learning fermentation and bioprocessing, you can excel yourself in various fields such as vaccine, biosimilars, therapeutics, diagnostic, regenerative medicine, medical technology, wherein vaccines and biosimilars constitute the largest component of the India pharmaceutical segment. So this is a picture where it shows about the topmost companies wherein they make use of the concepts of fermentation and bioprocessing. On successful completion of this program, the students will be placed in various industries of pharmaceuticals and biotechnology domain, where you can work as quality control, as in the form of analyst or supervisor, quality assurance analyst or supervisor, scientist at the level 1, R&D, biologists or biopharmaceuticals, or in the field of upstream development, as in the form of executive or senior executives, downstream development as executives or senior executives, or you can even work as JRF or SRF in some of the premier central research institutes. Now, I would request the next speaker, Dr. B.Y. Satish Kumar from JSS College, to enlighten on the domain protein expression and scale-up.
Thank you, Ms. Prathana. Good evening, one and all. I am Dr. Satish from JSS College, Mysore, acting as a coordinator for the BiSEP program of the Government of Karnataka and the Government of India sponsored programs. In our institute, we are offering protein expression and scale-up as the domain of study. You must have, by this time, you must have understood that the importance of proteins. Importance of proteins. Why proteins are necessary? As you all know that proteins are instrumental in all biochemical transformations that occurs in any living systems. Those are the functional molecules. At the end, those are proteins are the functional molecules. Coming to the applications of proteins with respect to biotechnology industry, people are trying to make the recombinant proteins in various approaches for their research as well as for making commercial biotechnological products. And novel approaches for production of some important therapeutic drugs or proteins are also going on. To explore the possibilities of production of recombinant proteins, which can be directly or indirectly used for various therapeutic and other applications in biopharmaceutical products production, as well as nutraceuticals, as well as household care products. In that way, proteins plays a very major role in the biotech industries. Coming to the bioproducts and market analysis, the biopharmaceutical products are improving the quality of life and reducing the death rates in patients with HIV or AIDS, cancer patients, cystic fibrosis, rheumatoid arthritis, etc., etc. The efficacy of drug and their safety has increased the acceptance of biopharmaceuticals, especially when it comes to enzymes or the hormones or the proteins for that matter. That's why its acceptance, the efficacy and the safety of the drug are some of the key product features that drives the market growth of the biopharmaceuticals. The global biopharmaceutical market is estimated to reach $341 billion US dollars by 2023. Biopharmaceuticals generate a global revenue of $163 billion US dollars, making up to 20% of the pharma industry. Means slowly, at least not of the late, slowly all the pharma industries are coming towards biopharma products for their efficacy as well as looking at the safety of the drugs. It's by far the fastest growing part of the industry. Biopharma's current annual growth rate of more than 8% is doubled that of conventional pharma, and growth is expected to continue at that rate for the foreseeable future. The top 15 biopharma products each enjoy annual revenue of more than $2 billion with some such an anti-inflammatory drugs called as Humira, generating sales of more than $10 billion a year. The top biopharma for many players, the biggest challenge has been simply making enough products to sell. That is the biggest challenge in this biopharma industry with respect to proteins or the enzymes or the antibodies. They could not able to supply the requirement of the market. For many players, the biggest challenge has been simply making enough products to sell. It's no surprise that major pharmaceutical companies around the world are increasingly shifting their R&D and sourcing focus to this large molecule products. My next slide gives you the market share of biopharma industry with respect to proteins and other proteinaceous molecules, which is increasingly growing from pharma side to biopharma side. With this, I would like to invite you all to join this protein expression scale-up domain under this BiSEP program, which is a future job provider, and as the estimated job market, there will be 30 to 35% in protein or enzyme manufacturing industries in next 5 years, and correspondingly jobs are also get opened in this particular field. The associated industry with this protein expression and scale-up domain are Campbell Biopharma, Richcore Life Sciences, Thermo Fisher Scientifics, Prosetta Bioinformatics, Viprogen Life Sciences, Genie, Hindustan Unilever, Theraindex, Novozymes, all are our collaborators for this particular domain of study. With this, the strength of this domain is the requirement by the industries. How much we are giving from our institute from this particular domain, that much is all of them are getting absorbed by the industry at the end of their internship. With this, I'll thank you for your patience hearing, and I'll invite the next speaker. As it was mentioned in the earlier, the food processing and nutraceuticals will be detailed by Dr. Anuradha of Padma Shri Institute of Management. She'll take the lead of the state. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Satish. I'm Dr. Anuradha. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm going to deliberate about nutraceuticals and food processing domain. This particular domain is being offered by Padma Shri Institute of Management and Sciences and Bashveshwara Engineering College, Bagalkot. As all of you know, prevention is better than cure. If you don't eat food like medicine, you may have to end up eating medicines like your food. That is the saying. And all of you know that nowadays food industry is growing with a rapid pace, and everyone are very much interested to know what is happening in this particular segment. As you know, our day starts with processed food, a hot cup of coffee. This hot cup of coffee doesn't come to your table as such. It just starts from farm to cup, farm to fork. There is a lot of value addition happening in these places. And a simple breakfast like idli, you may be thinking that it is just an idli, but suddenly with this growing speed of time and with the growing population and growing fastness, we are really unaware of the things happening around. A small company which started with 7 employees now is having 16,000 chain of stores across 7 cities, and it is having more than 13,000 employees, and their turnover is 100 crores. This happened within a short period of time. This idli batter, which is a small innovation but a wonderful innovation where lot of food technologists are involved, because it should not get spoiled, it should retain its texture, and it should give the same kind of idli what a mother makes with lot of effort. When it comes to the industries which are involved in this food segment, are plenty of industries are involved in this food segment, starting from dairy milk products, confectioneries, beverages, meat and meat products, flavors, ice creams, sports nutrition products, geriatric nutrition products, chocolates, flavors, functional foods, superfoods, many more. Food industry is growing beyond our imagination. Here I want to give you one more very, very interesting example, that is meatless meat. Have you heard about meatless meat? Vegans who are converted from non-vegetarian food to vegetarian food still would like to have a vegetarian burger, but with the same taste of non-vegetarian food. So there is a company which provides meatless meat, which have identified as the same protein which gives you the taste and flavor of meat. This is a meatless meat company. We are going to an extent of growing chicken and meat in laboratory. Absolutely no killing. So this can be, we can have this food without bothering about killing an animal. Coming to companies, starting from pickling company to advanced tissue engineering, there are 160,000 companies listed recently, and 850 exhibitors are there in your World Food India conference. The value chain of food industry starts from raw material, isolation and purification, formulations, product design and development, scaling up, industrial production, packaging and labeling, consumers and distribution. You can fit into any one of these value chains, and there are industries which are dealing with only raw material, which are dealing with formulations, which are dealing with job works, which are dealing with marketing and product development. The strengths and expertise of BiSEP institutions, whichever BiSEP institution it is, the journey has started 6 years back as a biotech finishing school program, and these institutions have been selected based upon their strengths and expertise by a monitoring committee where top known scientists were heading the monitoring committee, and this is based upon the industry tie-ups. Almost all of the BiSEP institutes have got more than 10 industry tie-ups as MOUs and another 50 to 100 industry tie-ups is in an informal way. As this slide shows, all our students who worked with Padma Shri Institute of Management and Sciences earlier for past 5 years are placed in companies like Nestle, Haldiram's, Bikaneri Wala, Himalaya Drugs, Hector Beverages, Britannia, MTR, to name a few. Apart from this, now this BiTech finishing school has taken a giant leap after LSSDC has entered into an agreement with this KTech, who are facilitating BiSEP institutions. You may be wondering, what is the role of LSSDC here? LSSDC is Life Science Skill Development Sector Council, where they are going to test the students based upon the job roles like quality control, quality assurance, product development, and business development, whichever job roles the student chooses in the first 6 months of their coursework. During this 1 year program, the student will undergo a stringent and very compactly organized curriculum where they need to really have hands-on experience on almost all the techniques which are involved in food and nutraceutical industry. Each institute is equipped with doctorates and industry experts, experienced faculty, and many visiting faculty. They visit not less than 20 industries during 1 year of their program, which includes top institutions like Indian Institute of Horticulture Science, CFTRI, or Institute of Horticulture, etc. Apart from this, students are also being given with individual projects during their coursework. For example, our students are involved in development of products like, very interesting products like alternatives to saffron. Do you know the cost of saffron? 1 kilogram of saffron costs more than 2.5. Work in the institution, the students are really, their innovativeness and creativeness is ignited, and students are allowed to come out with the novel ideas. Our students developed a product which can replace saffron, which is costing you nothing. The plant is there right away in your garden, and the pedicel of night jasmine can be used instead of saffron, which is the costliest, world's costliest spice. The student bagged prize in Bangalore India Bio for this particular product development. Apart from this, our students are also coming out with novel ideas, like one of our students want to develop a product for hypertension people. This is an anti-hypertension product. For example, all of you might be knowing anti-diabetic products, but many of you may not be aware of anti-hypertensive products like less salt or saltless snack. What do you mean by this saltless snack? Without salt, how can we eat chips? Without salt, how can you eat finger chips or any other chakli or any other murku? These students have come out with salt, which is having with less, it is an FDA approved salt, and with this they made pickles, and finally a product is out. One of the company has seen this product and they offered a job to these students. And our students have worked with preservative modes like you want to have cut fruits while traveling, but the fruit should not become brown in color. Like apple, once you cut it, it becomes brown in color. So students have come out with a chitin and chitosan based product where turmeric is used as an antioxidant and ascorbic acid is used as an antioxidant so that you can eat a fruit without any brown tinge even after 3 hours of cutting. This is the preservation technology standardized at our institution. Apart from this, students are really ignited and a proper ecosystem has been provided to the students to develop not only products, to get trained as quality control biologists. With the recent FSSI involvement, there is a stringent rule by the FSSI and all other regulatory authorities that every food industry need to have a quality control department, and this quality control department need to be headed by a quality control trainer, a person who is trained in quality control and regulations. At Padma Shri Institute of Management and Sciences and Vashveshwara Engineering College, there is a quality control and quality assurance training provided during the coursework. And with this, I thank all of you for your patient listening, and I hand over to Dr. Kavishri, who is going to brief you about cellular and molecular diagnostics.
Hi everyone, good evening to all of you. I'm here again to provide you all an overview on the domain cellular and molecular diagnostics. The domain cellular and molecular diagnostics, especially the medical diagnostic market, is playing a very key important role in the ever-changing healthcare and drug discovery landscape. Novel platform technologies and a better understanding of them are driving the development of molecular diagnostics. The molecular diagnostics involves the measurement of biomolecules like DNA, RNA, proteins or metabolites in order to detect genotypic, mutational or biochemical changes in the body. The objective is to test for specific states of health or to see if disease exists in blood, tissue or bones. Molecular diagnostics has made it possible to detect infectious diseases and cancer more accurately and precisely at an early stage than before. The technology is also optimizing testing for sexually transmitted diseases and genetic testing. Molecular diagnostics is also addressing the need for tests that monitor the therapeutic efficacy of pharmaceuticals. In this way, it has evolved into an important global business opportunity. The global cellular and molecular diagnostic market is segmented into instruments, reagents, and others. The diagnostic reagent market has always shown a fast growing trend. This market is still at its infancy and therefore is poised to grow. In 2016, the global in vitro diagnostics market was valued at $61.6 billion and with an expected compound annual growth rate of 4.6%, and it will reach $84.6 billion by 2023. The growing acceptance of cellular and molecular diagnostics is the top key factor driving this growth. Asia Pacific is fastest growing market region for this domain. According to the latest market research, Indian Diagnostic Services Market Outlook 2020, the diagnostic services market is expected to continue growing at 27.5% for the next 5 years. With the rise in health consciousness in the society and the rising burden of chronic diseases, this market will swell to approximately INR 860 billion in revenues market by 2020. The current technologies that are driving the market are immunodiagnostics, hybridization and array methods, sequencing and amplification based methods. The trends are fast changing at an enormous pace. Coming to the changing trends, our conventional methods traditionally lacked scalability and required high turnaround times, but novel developments has the ability to scale up and use medium to high throughput systems easily. Continuous innovation in technology is increasing the speed and performance of cellular and molecular diagnostics. The current research is driven by genomics and proteomics platforms that individual tailor-made treatments are not very far away. Personalized medicine has the potential to eliminate unnecessary treatments, reduce the incidence of adverse reactions to drugs, increase the efficacy of treatments, and ultimately improve the health outcome. Omics-based integrated approaches and biomarker identification is going to drive diagnostics at the fast pace with the development of methods and technologies for the point-of-care devices for early, cheap, accurate, and quick diagnostics. The companion diagnostics, linking drugs with diagnostics, is expected to become the future healthcare model, offering advantages for both the prescription drug and the diagnostic businesses. High throughput methods are being developed for genetic testing, prenatal testing, cancer diagnosis, infectious diseases, and for transplantation studies. Biomarkers of disease can also be detected using proteomics and metabolomic technologies in the tiniest amounts of bodily fluids. The technology drivers for this industry are polymerase chain reaction, real-time PCR, FISH, that is fluorescent in situ hybridization, microarray, transcription-mediated amplification, next-generation sequencing, and mass spectrometry. Coming to the role of cellular and molecular diagnostics in improving the healthcare. One of the major advantages of cellular and molecular diagnostics have over conventional diagnostic methods is the ability to scale up methods and use the medium to high throughput systems easily. All the diseases, including cancer subtypes, usually require individual specialized diagnostic tests to establish a positive diagnosis before treatment can begin. Nucleic acid-based diagnostic assays, which rely on disease-specific biomarkers, can potentially detect specific diseases quickly and early. A number of companies have invested heavily in this market space and are working to bring cheaper, accurate, and quick diagnostic methods to patients. Nucleic acid sequencing giant Illumina has launched an independent business called GRAIL, which aims to isolate cell-free DNA and RNA molecules shed by tumors in blood and use deep sequencing to develop a direct measure of cancer. This process has been dubbed liquid biopsy, and a number of other companies such as Kiagen, Raindance, and Genomic Health are working on developing similar concepts. Other small molecules such as metabolites, peptides, and proteins present in bodily fluids and tissues also serve as biomarkers of disease, and these are increasingly being utilized for disease diagnosis, treatment, and management. Mass spectrometry, another Nobel Prize-winning technology, can be reliably employed to detect most small biomolecules in any sample and is moving into the diagnostic sphere. MS-based devices such as the mass spec pen and eye knife are already helping surgeons in defining the boundaries of cancerous tissues to achieve precision during surgery. The huge potential of applications of MS technology is reflected in the tremendous growth in both instrumentation and analysis software in this sector. The mass spectrometry market is expected to reach $7.2 billion by 2020 from $4.9 billion in 2015 at an impressive compound annual growth rate of 8.1%. The key players in this sector are Roche Diagnostics, Abbott Laboratories, Siemens Healthcare, Thermo Fisher Scientific, Danaher Corporation, Sysmex Corporation, Bio-Rad Laboratories, Johnson & Johnson, Becton Dickinson & Company, Kiagen, Ortho Clinical Diagnostics, and Diasorin, to name a few. Coming to the cellular and molecular diagnostics domain under BiSEP program, the cellular and molecular diagnostics, the recent emergence of this field as a sector has created a tremendous need for human resource skilled in molecular techniques and immunology. The ever-increasing super specialty hospitals and oncology departments has skilled manpower crunch. The postgraduate program offered by various universities in India does not adequately address this problem, either due to the lack of required infrastructure or due to the lack of trained faculty members. The students who are selected for this program undergo 6 months of training in the college and an internship in the industry for the next 6 months. During their stay in the college, they are trained in the domains of molecular biology, clinical biochemistry, genetics, cell biology, oncology, immunology, genomics, and proteomics. During their stay, they will be trained in all molecular biological techniques, including the PCR, omics approach, Sanger sequencing, next generation sequencing, biomarker identification, regulatory requirements for diagnostic market, IPR, and so on. An additional elective module that is included in their curriculum in order to hone their skills to meet the requirements of biopharmaceutical industry. The guest lectures by industry experts and industry visits provide them a real-time exposure and visibility to the students. The soft skill programs in communication, grooming, interpersonal skills, and teamwork provided during this program increase their employability in the industry. The placement records of our students from the 5 batches of BTFS program is a testimony for the same. Out of 139 students, 105 students have been placed in reputed industries in India like AstraZeneca, Biocon, Syngene, Sartorius, Invitrogen, Thermo Fisher, Shanta Biotechnics, Serum Institute of India, and Stemputics, to name a few. Coming to the job roles, once they are trained under the BiSEP program, the students will become industry ready and they will take up any job roles from biomarker development to market analyst or also a business development associate. The cellular and molecular diagnostics domain was offered by 2 institutions, namely the Oxford College of Science, Bangalore, and Manipal School of Life Sciences, Manipal University. Due to the increasing demand for this program, now it is being offered by 4 institutions, including Mount Carmel College, Bangalore, and SDM College of Medical Sciences and Hospital, Dharwad. The syllabus for this program has been extensively reviewed and revised with inputs from the industry experts in order to meet the current demands in the industry. The session now is open for question queries. The participants can send in their queries either through chat option or also they can send in their queries to our mail ID, that is bisep.ktech@ka.gov.in. I repeat, the queries can be sent either through the chat option that is available in the session, or also you can send your queries to bisep.ktech@ka.gov.in. And our WhatsApp number is 944-84-70039. I repeat, 944-84-70039. Thank you. Before I conclude and answer the chat questions, I have few frequently asked questions which I would be clarifying it right now. Some of the frequently asked questions include, what is the role of LSSDC? Now, as explained by Dr. Anuradha in her session, LSSDC is nothing but Life Science Skill Sectoral Development Council. And the KTech have tied up with the LSSDC in order to make our BiSEP program much more industry oriented, as during these days, most of the skill that is being taken up by the industry and the students who are taken up by the industry need to be skill ready. And for this, you need to get certified from the Skill Development Council, and for which reason, BiSEP program that is KTech, that is being offered by the KTech, they have tied up with the LSSDC in order to make it much more efficient for our students and much more useful for them to become industry ready and employable. And for that reason, what is going to happen in this LSSDC is that the students will be offered an elective in the first semester, wherein they will be trained with four job roles, especially the quality assurance and quality development, the technology transfer by process development, product development, and also business development executive, and many more job roles which is being taken up by the institutes, which is already being displayed in the website. Now, for these job roles, usually the training will, the theory training will happen, and also the practical approach and also the industry training will happen initially in the first semester, whereas the assessment for the same will be taken up in the second semester end, which will be done by the LSSDC themselves. They are going to assess the students and then they are going to certify them. At the end of two semester, the student will be receiving certification from LSSDC, a certificate from the KTech for having completed the BiSEP program, and also they will be receiving a PG diploma certificate from the respective institutions or the universities. Another frequently asked question is that, can the student take up internship abroad? Yes, definitely the student can take up the internship abroad. However, the student has to send in their attendance details and many more such requirements that are required to the respective BiSEP coordinator who are available in India. And also, first 6 months, they have to undergo training in the respective host institutions that are available in India. And then from there, they can, for the second semester during the internship program, they can take up this in the foreign universities as well, foreign industries as well. Now, what will happen if I get the job instead of internship? Definitely, the program aims at making the students employable. So, for which reason? Naturally, internship is a passport that we are giving you in order to enter into an industry. Suppose you are getting a job and you are becoming industry ready before being taking up internship, you are most welcome to join for the job role that you are going to get. However, they can avail either the fellowship or the salary that they are going to get with the job that they are getting offered with. So any one place they can take the salary, they cannot draw the salary in both the places. That is the only terms and condition, they can definitely take up the job. Another frequently asked question is that what is the certificate awarded after the PG, after the completion of the course? As I mentioned earlier, three certificates the candidate is going to get. One is the PG diploma certificate from the affiliating university, respective affiliating university, and one certificate will be given by the KTEC, Government of Karnataka, for having completed the program. And one more certificate the student would be getting after the completion of two semesters by the LSSDC, which is going to give them more opportunity and which is going to make them more and more employable in the industry. The next question is, can I get a bank loan? Definitely yes, you can definitely ask for the bank loan. However, as per the BiSEP program, the students, usually the Karnataka students, are already getting the benefit of waiver of rupees 25,000. That means 25,000 is being paid by the Government of Karnataka for the Karnataka students, and the students of Karnataka have to pay only rupees 25,000 as the initial tuition fee. So that is already waived off is there. Beyond this, if a student wishes to take the educational loan, he or she is most welcome to do that. Now, many of you may be having a query that the results are out for some of you, whereas for some of you, even the final, some of the PG students, even the final semester result is not out. Are they eligible?